So most of what we have on the board here is where we ended up when we talked about the Jacobi iteration. Now, this equation was really the same as that equation, so we can take the iteration numbers that we have and put them up here, and then implicitly these two equations actually tell the same story. So here we say this is the k plus first iteration value, and all of these are the values at the current iteration, or the previous values, k, however you want to look at it. Okay? Now, let's think about how the Jacobi iteration went. What it said was, take all of these values and replace them by taking the values around them, some linear combination of them to update them, and use the old values. Now, it may be that you're on a computer where all of this happens simultaneously, and then you get a lot of parallelism. But if you actually do it one by one, then you'll end up updating this value, and then this value, and this value, and then this value, and this value, and so forth. And if you do the Jacobi iteration, you end up, first of all, having to store the old values, because otherwise you would use overwritten values, so you would need to double the amount of storage that you would have to keep around. And second, if you think about it, if I update this value, then by the time I get to this value, why shouldn't I just go ahead and use the updated value here as opposed to the old value? Okay, this value is moving towards the value that it ultimately should be. Therefore, I should use it when I get here because presumably it's a better value. All right? Now, if you think about that, what that means is that the values that have an index that is smaller have already been updated, but the values that have an index that's larger have not yet been updated. So all of these values here become k plus 1, and all of these values are the original values. Okay? Now, that means that when by the time we get here, we get a plus 1 here and a plus 1 here to make this equivalent to that again. And then we can take all of the values that have already been updated and move them to the left by subtracting these off and moving the equal sign here. And if you work out the details of this, what that means is that we take away all of these subdiagonal entries and we move them back to the left-hand side. Right here. All right? And you may want to look at the notes and kind of contemplate the details. Now, what does that mean? What that means is that our splitting here now becomes where n is the diagonal plus the strictly lower, sorry, minus the negative of the strictly lower triangular part. Remember that A we split into D minus L transpose. So this becomes your M, and your N becomes L. Okay, so this iteration would say take D plus, sorry, minus L. Well, that's actually L transpose. And solve this. Not solve it, but perform this iteration instead. Okay? Now, notice that this is a sparse matrix vector multiply, and it's easier to take advantage of sparsity in a matrix vector multiply, because you just don't compute with the zeros. And this here then would mean that you have to do a sparse lower triangular solve. And if you think about it, in the triangular solves, you end up doing, you know, something like dot products of rows to, with updated values, etc. And it's not hard to see that, hey, you can take advantage of zeros during the triangular solve as well. So all of this can take advantage of the non-zeros. And you keep doing this until these values stabilize, until they converge. And once they converge, you have an approximation to the actual solution that you were looking for. And the important thing is here, while you're doing many iterations of computation, each iteration is cheap. The computation associated with each iteration is roughly proportional to the number of non-zeros in the matrix. Okay, now this particular method is known as the Gauss Seidel iteration. Jacobi was a very famous mathematician who lived maybe 150 years ago or so. Seidel was one of his students.